Hi, this is Steve Miglotti from Azure Government Engineering. I have with me today Scott Oxley, also from Azure Government Engineering, and we're going to be talking about infrastructure security on Azure Government. Welcome, Scott. So, Scott, I know that you are a security architect and you've been working with many government customers. So I guess the first question I have is, how do you think about cloud security architecture? And maybe more importantly, how do you want your customers to think about it? I know a lot of the customers, they're coming from a world of, they have their on-premise data center where they're used to being able to reach out and touch their servers and having complete control. So moving to the cloud is a shift for them. So when you're working with them, what do you tell them and how do you want them to think about it?
Really, it's kind of starting that generational approach. You know, with the enterprise where they usually own all the hardware, they see it, they run their data centers. And that's kind of morphed over the years that they get that network service provider, that provider that's actually running into stuff for them. Well, this is that next generation where it's basically you still have your assets, you still can view those as, you know, virtual objects or virtual, you know, session services, but now the physical part of it becomes, you know, much more advanced, much more complex, and you still have the same view you had before, you just don't have those physical individual servers that you could touch before.
Okay, makes sense. So it's just a mindset shift, but you can do a lot of the similar things you could do before.
Yeah, very similar things, very similar approaches. So in that security approach is really back to the basics are still there, they're still the same. And then working with those, working with customers to understand how they transition or actually support and bring those into their...
Okay. So when you explain it like that, it's not so scary. Yeah. Okay. So now that I understand a little bit about how to think about it, from a big picture perspective, you know, what are we talking about from a big picture? What do you communicate there?
Yeah. So a lot of it is really trying to go just the basics of a layered defense. Really, you know, kind of saying it doesn't go away in your enterprise and in the cloud is the same capabilities is to really create layered defense for your services that you move out there. Whether those be, you know, IaaS or PaaS services, whether you have an extension of your network or you're setting up a small, you know, enclave or other, you know, supported environment for a service.
Okay, so extension of your network. So this is something like something connected with ExpressRoute?
Yeah, so ExpressRoute comes into play this way, or VPN even. You can actually create a set of virtual networks, set of services that you deploy your servers on that connect back to your own enterprise network and maybe don't connect to the internet.
So I don't have to go all cloud. I don't have to do all or nothing. I can extend my current data center, not necessarily do away with my on-prem data center and extend it.
Exactly. So I can actually start to create these hybrid services where I have, you know, my back-end enterprise services also influencing or controlling my services I put in the cloud.
Okay. I'm hearing the theme of this, the layers, security architecture in layers, not just one thing, not just one silver bullet, but really having that defense in depth.
Yeah, that defense in depth. And like I like to start off with is one of the things you get out of the cloud that you don't normally have in enterprise is a worldwide defense, you know, DDoS protection.
Yeah, it's a good point. So that's something that Microsoft is handling in their infrastructure, right?
Yeah. So we actually have, you know, we connect to ISPs worldwide.
Okay.
As an attack would happen or something like that, usually those are regionalized, and we can actually isolate those to a region and mitigate them. So they never actually get back to that full strength attack to a service.
Okay.
So that's kind of one of those neat things that we could do as a cloud provider.
Okay.
Going down below that, now this gets into where customers have the ability to define how they actually want their environment to look and operate.
Okay, so what do you mean by virtual network isolation?
So basically, a customer has the ability to create virtual networks. These are networks that they actually define. They define the IP addressing on it. They actually control it. It's not controlled by the cloud service. It's controlled by the customers. So the definitions are theirs. You go deeper, they can create, subdivide that into subnets, and again, also apply their own addressing, how they want that to manage, and how they want each of those subnets to communicate to each other. You know, that gets into this section of where they can define what networks, what devices sit on what networks, their IP addressing, and this gets back into a gateway back to, you know, their on-prem through ExpressRoute or to the internet through load balancers or other gateways that way.
So I'm hearing you talk about subnets, and I'm hearing you talk about, as a developer, I put my developer hat on, I think to myself, oh, this sounds a little bit like, you know, my business tier and my data tier and my web tier. Am I sort of on the right track there?
Yeah, very much so. So again, you can have between two subnets, I can actually create one as being my back end or my DMZ, my mid tier, and I can actually have functions between those to route between those, what is allowed to flow, what is not allowed to flow.
So that actually sounds pretty familiar to something I might do in an on-prem data center anyway. So again, we're very familiar concepts there. And when you're talking about what's allowed to flow, I heard you mention something a few minutes ago, network security groups, and it sounded a lot like you were talking about something like a firewall. Am I thinking about that right? What is a network security group?
Yeah, network security groups are really a step below the firewall. So these are more of the basic router ACLs or traditional just hard rules that you set up to what is allowed, what is not to allow.
Okay.
You have the ability to set both ingress and egress rules, and you can set those by basically on a virtual network, on an individual subnet, or against an individual host. So these actually run below the layer of your virtual network. They run actually outside of your traditional network flows, and they're actually operated at that hypervisor level or within the base root of the cloud.
Okay, so conceptually it sounds like a firewall because we're talking about things like which IP ranges or even specific IP addresses,
yes,
what's available on what port. But you say it's not exactly a firewall. It's one level.
No, it's actually a lower layer. So again, it basically has some hard, fast rules about what it will allow or not allow. Now, you want to get that firewall approach, whether it be a web application firewall or a network-based firewall, you still have that ability to do that through appliances. You have the ability to bring up those appliances and define the network routes that will flow through that device. And now you actually get that high level, layer 4 level of firewall protection that you're expecting or used to.
I'm seeing the common theme here, which again goes back to that those layers. Not only do we have the NSGs, but also we can additionally put a firewall. And I saw on that last picture there, you had the different subnets and you had your business tier and data tier. I also saw a front end tier. So me as a web developer, I see that front end tier and I think, oh, that looks a lot like a DMZ. Is that subnet a DMZ? What if I want to secure my DMZ even further?
Yeah, so the DMZ, you do have that ability. It's like you could actually put in one of these appliances to be your DMZ out to the internet. So again, if you're protecting a web service front end or other API interface or things like that, you can put in really the appliance that makes sense for what the traffic flow you want to go through there. Then you have the ability to also put that in between, say, your DMZ and your mid-tier, or even your back-end back to your on-prem.
Oh, I see. So this network virtual appliance isn't necessarily just for a DMZ. I can actually use it anywhere?
Yeah, it can be used anywhere in that because, again, you as the customer control the flows between your networks. You define your networks, and you define the appliances that that traffic flows through.
So these pictures you have on this slide here, I'm looking at a lot of these, and these look like the same appliances that maybe I've seen in a traditional data center. Is it accurate for me to say that, are they the same, or are they sort of software equivalents? Help me understand that a little
bit. Yeah, pretty much software equivalents. Most of these companies have been producing virtual firewalls, virtual appliances for years now. These are the same code bases that they have for whether it be on a physical appliance or the virtualized appliance. So you get the same capabilities, again, based on what they've released for the version and product and environment. And then within, I'll say, the cloud environment, Azure Government, you have the ability to actually select the size of machine you're actually going to run that appliance on. So if you need one with, you know, two interfaces, you can do that virtual machine that way with so much memory, so much CPU processing capability, or scale that up as you need.
Okay, cool. So, wow, there's a lot of layers to this, no pun intended. Yeah. But again, it's the defense in depth and a lot of options, very robust, that we have available. Any closing thoughts or key takeaways that we should keep in mind?
Yeah, I think it's really just back to, it's like, this doesn't really change how you approach security. It really just expands what you can do, the agility you have, but those basics that you secure your environment with now still apply to the cloud. It's just, again, getting back to what is the capability you're trying to do, what are you trying to protect, and what's the best way to proceed with that?
Okay, great. Makes sense. That's been very helpful. Okay, this has been Steve Michelotti with Scott Oxley talking about security in Azure Government. Thanks for listening.